Hello, anatomy colleagues. This is Dr. Alsup, and in this video, we will be discussing the histology of bone tissue, or in other words, the structure of bone at the microscopic level. Now, I know the majority focus of this course is gross anatomy, or the anatomical structures that you can see with the naked eye, but I feel that having knowledge of the microscopic building blocks can really help in the understanding of these gross structures, and really additionally help with the understanding of the functions, which is kind of the main point anyway. So we need to review these things, we need to get these concepts before really getting into the separate bones. So let's get started. So as you can see here, we have quite a bit to discuss here, including cells, the extracellular matrix, which is very important in terms of all connective tissues, but certainly in terms of osseous tissue. And we'll even touch on a few pathological areas in the case of rickets and osteomalacia, and how that is going to be affected by changes or issues with the extracellular matrix. So let's get going. There are going to be four types of cells present in osseous tissue. And we are going to review each one, starting with the osteogenic cells. And sometimes you hear this referred to as the osteoprogenitor stem cells, because they are that. That's exactly what they are. They're these unspecialized bone stem cells. Osteogenic cells are derived from mesenchyme, which is the embryonic tissue from which almost all connective tissues are formed. And bone is a connective tissue, so it makes sense that it will be derived from the mesenchyme. Now, this is an important point, so let's put a little star next to it. These are the only bone cells, so these osteogenic cells are the only bone cells to undergo cell division. So none of the other three that we discuss will be able to do that. And as these cells divide, they will eventually develop or convert into osteoblasts, which are very important in terms of bone tissue deposition. Osteogenic cells can be found throughout life, so that's an important idea as well. You do have osteogenic cells throughout life, and these will be found within the inner portions of the outer periosteum. You'll also find them around the endosteum, or the inner portions of the bone, or surrounding the inner portions of the bone, and you'll also have them in many of the neurovascular canals of bone. Okay. So now we know that the osteogenic cells will develop into osteoblasts. Let's talk about what an osteoblast is. So this is the second cell that we are going to talk about. Simply put, osteoblasts are bone-building cells. All right? So osteoblasts build. All right? So we'll talk about how this is going to be almost an opposite function of the osteoclasts. Bone-building cells are going to produce and secrete collagen fibers and other organic components. So this is important. These are going to be the organic components of the extracellular matrix. And it is these organic components that are needed to initiate calcification or tissue hardening. So making that tissue hard, and in this case we're talking bone tissue hardening, which we know is going to be very important in terms of the structure of bone. Now, osteoblasts will continually secrete and surround itself with these components of the extracellular matrix, eventually becoming essentially trapped in their own secretions. And at the point that these cells are completely surrounded and trapped in extracellular matrix, there will be the stopping of secretion of the organic materials, and the osteoblast will transition into an osteocyte. But before we move on to osteocytes, I want to take a little break and really explore the extracellular matrix of bone, making sure we are comfortable with its basic components. Extracellular matrix is the material located between widely spaced cells, and it will differ considerably between different types of tissues. and it's really the structure of the extracellular matrix that determines much of the tissue's qualities. So, for example, in cartilage, the extracellular matrix is firm, but more pliable or flexible, while the extracellular matrix of bone will be much harder and less flexible, and it's all due to the components within. So the major components of bone extracellular matrix will be water. It will be organic materials, mainly collagen fibers. And importantly, you will also have inorganic materials that are going to be these crystallized mineral salts. So let's talk a little bit about this inorganic material. The most abundant mineral salt is going to be calcium phosphate, which will combine with calcium hydroxide, and this will form crystals of hydroxyapatite right here. Now, I don't want you to worry about this chemical formula here. I just put it here because it looks so cool, and if you're into that kind of thing, I wanted you to be able to see really of what it's composed of. But I do want you to understand that this inorganic material is mostly going to be hydroxyapatite, which will combine with other mineral salts and ions, and this will be deposited amongst the organic framework formed by the collagen fibers that were secreted by those osteoblasts. Now, as more inorganic material is deposited, it will crystallize and the bone tissue will harden. In other words, the bone tissue will calcify. And it's important to note, you need both organic and inorganic materials for the process of calcification to occur. Now, a bone's hardness is dependent on those crystallized inorganic mineral salts, just as you would probably think, whereas a bone's flexibility is going to depend on that organic, the organic material or the collagen fibers. Now, you may be thinking to yourself, flexibility in a bone sounds like a bad thing. I don't want that. But you do need some flexibility in bone to allow for tensile strength, which is going to be that resistance to being stretched or torn apart. And it also helps to combat bone brittleness, which you can see kind of over here in a cartoonish image here. And so this bone brittleness can really lead to fragile bones, which may fracture or shatter more easily. Now, if you soak a bone in acidic solution, something as simple as vinegar, this will dissolve the mineral salts or that inorganic material and leave only the collagen fibers, making the bone extremely flexible or almost rubbery. So having that correct balance of organic and inorganic materials in the bony extracellular matrix is vital for proper bone health and function. But what happens if you don't have these proper balances, or say the calcification process is insufficient? You can have various pathological issues, and two of these are going to be rickets and osteomalacia. And these two disorders are going to be two forms of the same disorder. These are going to result from inadequate calcification or hardening of that extracellular matrix. And it's usually caused by an insufficient amount of vitamin D. Rickets is the name for this disorder, in juveniles. All right, so in children. And what you will observe is often a bowing of the legs due to the bones being more flexible or too flexible due to insufficient calcification. Osteomalacia, which sometimes you hear referred to as adult rickets, is going to be the same disorder, but as you can see here, in adults. So making sure an individual has sufficient vitamin D supplies, which can be helped with increased exposure to moderate amounts of sunlight, can really help in terms of lessening the effects of this disorder or preventing. Okay, that was a fun clinical vignette, but now let's return to the cells of bone tissue. Recall that we know that we have the cell-dividing osteogenic cells that will develop into osteoblasts. Those osteoblasts will secrete collagen fibers into the extracellular matrix, eventually surrounding and trapping itself within the matrix. And at that point, when it is trapped in the matrix and it has stopped secreting organic materials, that osteoblast will become an osteocyte. And these you can just think of as your mature bone cells, kind of the main cells in the bony tissue. Now, it's important to note that these cells, these osteocytes, are not dead. They are very much functioning in monitoring and maintaining the bone's metabolism through exchanging nutrients and getting rid of waste. And you can see in this illustration how these cells have these fairly long extensions or processes that are important in terms of being able to better communicate with other osteocytes that are widely separated. So be able to send information and certain components to osteocytes that are fairly far away. All right, so the fourth bone cell is a big one, and this is the osteoclast. Clast means break or break down, and this is exactly what an osteoclast does. You can see here kind of this mnemonic osteoclast with the C, consume or break down bone. And it will break down the extracellular matrix, which at first blush, I know actually sounds kind of pathological, but this is very much a natural and necessary process in maintaining a healthy skeleton, as long as these processes are in line with the osteoblasts or bone building cells. So you want them kind of working in unison. You don't want one working much faster than the other. Whereas the other three bone cells are part of a life cycle, the osteoclasts are going to have a different origin, developing from the fusion of many monocytes, which are a type of white blood cells. And this is actually going to be a really large or comparatively large cell. Osteoblasts can be found in numerous areas of the bone, but they are most concentrated in the endosteum, or that thin membrane lining the internal portion of the bone. And the cell has this very distinctive ruffled border, which I'm underlining right here. And this ruffled border will be facing the actual bone surface. And when needed, it will release lysosomal enzymes and acids that will be the component that will actually break down and digest the extracellular matrix components. And so this breakdown is what is referred to as bone resorption. So as I mentioned previously, this resorption is a part of typical bone development. It will be important in terms of bone growth, bone maintenance, and also repair. And it will also play a role in increasing blood calcium levels when necessary. All right, so as a quick review, you can see these osteogenic cells are kind of the first component of the life cycle. These will develop into osteoblasts, which play an important role in terms of formation of the bone matrix. Once these osteoblasts are trapped in extracellular matrix, and after organic material secretion ceases, an osteoblast will convert to an osteocyte, which is important in terms of maintaining the bone metabolism. So you can see that these three cells are part of one life cycle, whereas the osteoclast has a different origin, but is also important in the bone tissue, specifically in terms of bone resorption. Okay, let's work through two questions, as there were a lot of concepts covered here. And I suggest you stop and try to answer this question on your own, either writing it down or saying the answer out loud. So pause after I read here and kind of think this through. So the question is, you notice in a patient that there is a pathological amount of flexibility or softness in some of their bones. Which components of the extracellular matrix may be affected here? All right, so pause. And when you are ready, you can unpause the video and we will discuss this kind of together. So flexibility of bone, I'm going to underline that here, is a function of what? Is it a function of the organic or the inorganic components of the extracellular matrix? Hopefully you are feeling good that this is part of the organic portions or components of the extracellular matrix. So if a bone is too flexible, it is typically not the organic material that is insufficient. There could be issues with the calcification or hardening process of the inorganic material, or that hydroxyapatite. So really what we were going for here is that there is some issue with either the inorganic material being calcified or hardened within the extracellular matrix. All right, and we saw that this can often occur with rickets and osteomalacia due to most commonly vitamin D deficiency. All right, so hopefully this is something you're feeling good with. If not, go back and review that portion, or you can always reach out to me. But I do want one more question. Usually I only have one, but I do have two in this particular session. All right, so question is, which cell associated with osseous tissue plays the largest role in bone resorption? Is it osteoblasts, osteoclasts, osteocytes, or osteogenic cells? Pause the video if you need a moment to think, but once you are ready, let's discuss how B, or osteoclasts, is the correct answer. It is these large osteoclasts that will break down bony extracellular matrix, and this is referred to as bony resorption. Osteoblasts are, this is not correct, because these are going to be the portion, these cells are the ones that are going to lay down the organic material of the extracellular matrix, so these will be bone building, kind of the opposite, right, of the osteoclast. So these two kind of work in unison to do opposite functions. Osteocytes, these are not correct either, because these are those mature bone cells that play a role in bone maintenance, not breakdown. And lastly, osteogenic cells are not correct. These are the beginning of this life cycle here and important in terms of cell division. Okay, so this is likely one of my longest mini lectures, but I felt it was really important to keep these structures and concepts together. Please make sure you have these concepts down before moving on to other areas in this session, as the concepts here really help make sense of some of the ones we will discuss in subsequent videos. Please always feel free to reach out to me with any questions, and have a great day.